one of the points that was the oldest person in the white beard. And actually, it says in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it's because of Lord of Dvaitacharya that Mahaprabhu appeared. When he saw the effect of Kali Yuga and the onslaught of the Muslims, he was praying every day very fervently with tulsi leaves and water from the Ganges and asking the Lord to appear. And it is said because of his prayers, Lord Chaitanya appeared. He is very senior. Actually, he is a disciple of Madhavendra Acharya, whose disciple was Ishwaracharya, whose disciple was Mahaprabhu. So, Advaitacharya is much senior, but he served Mahaprabhu as a servant. So, it's very humbling and very exemplary thing to know that how humble the Vaishnavas can be. And we all pay our respectful obeisance to Lord Advaitacharya. Actually, this whole coming week is going to be very auspicious. A lot of Vaishnavas appear this week, including Lord Nityananda. So Lord Nityananda's Tridevashi on Tuesday. So we should all pray for their mercy on their appearance day. And so we will start with the Bhakti Bhiksha Ishopanishad. And I want you all to write to me or say something, you know, what your feedback is about this. So we are studying these books which are recommended by Prabhupada. They are all Prabhupada's books. And just like in network instruction we did, so this is Ishopanishad. And so we are studying it, but some of us are doing some Bhakti Shastri course, but it doesn't matter. You can attend this lectures and learn about Ishopanishad. Whether you are taking a course or exam or not, doesn't matter. So, and this is going to be systematic study and going to go at a good pace. So we are now on shloka number 8. So we are almost in the middle of the shloka. We finished half of it. And after this shloka, we will take Bhakti Shastri. There is a written exam. I have to do something about it. Please with me. There is an open book written in there, so that's why we just do one shloka today. And as you all know, Ishopanishad is taken from Yajurveda, and Upanishads are the crown jewels of Vedas. So the very important parts of the Vedas are taken and made into Upanishads. And the real meaning of Upanishad is when you are sitting next to the Guru and taking knowledge. And in this case, we are sitting at the feet of Srila Prabhupada because he translated all these books and gave us the knowledge. Because without the purpose, nobody can understand the real meaning of these shlokas, which are written in Sanskrit and have very deep meanings. So, we will sing Jai Radha Madhava to start with. So please follow with me. Jai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Gopinanda Vallabha Vivar Dhari. Thank you.
Screen.
Huh? Why is it not coming there?
You press F5. Yeah, nice.
I'm still not very technical about this PowerPoint, so I need my assistant. So we'll do the recite the mantra. Sa
Sa
Pariyagachu
Paryadash.
Kram kayam. Avaranam.
Avaranam.
Sanaviram.
Sanaviram.
Shuddham.
Shuddham.
Papa vidham.
Papa vidham.
Kavir.
Kavir.
Manishi.
Manishi.
Paribhuha.
Paribhuha.
Swambhur.
Swambhur.
Yathat.
Yathat.
Athyo. Arthan.
Arthan.
Vedada.
Vedada.
Achashtibhyaha.
Achashtibhyaha.
Samabhyaha.
Samabhyaha.
So now we're going to speak it together. Sahaparyagachu kram kayam varnam ashnaviram. Sahaparyagachu kram kayam varnam ashnaviram. Shuddham papa vidham.
Shuddham papa vidham.
Kavir manishi paribhu swambhur. Yathatathyut arthan. Vedadhaccha ashrutibhyaha samabhyaha.
Vedadhaccha ashrutibhyaha samabhyaha.
We'll do one more time, it's difficult words, but if you will be practice, it will become better at anything else. Sa paryagachu karam kayam avaranam.
Sa paryagachu
karam kayam avaranam. Sanaviram shuddham papa vidham. Kavir manishi paribhu swayambhur. Yatha tathyato arthan. Vedadhaccha shrutibhyaha. Samabhyaha. So the Vedas are, you know, very difficult and high level Sanskrit. So we have to repeat it many times to learn the flow of the, or the meter of the shloka. Now we'll read the word by word translation. Saha, that person. You can repeat after me. Saha, that person. Prayagat. Must know in fact. Shukram. The omnipotent, akayam,
unembodied,
avaranam,
avaranam,
without reproach,
ashnaviram,
without veins, shuddham,
antiseptic,
apapavidham,
prophylactic,
kavi,
omniscient,
manishi, philosopher,
paribhu,
the greatest of all, swambhu,
self-sufficient,
yathat tathyataha,
just in pursuance of,
arthan,
desirables,
vyadhadhat,
awards,
sashvati bhyaha,
immemorial.
Samabhyaha.
Samabhyaha.
Time. So now, the Sanskrit is a very unique language. There is no order of these, you know, the noun, the pronoun, the verb, and the adverb. It can be in any order and it can make sense. That's only unique to the Sanskrit language. So the translation of the whole verse is, such a person must actually know the greatest of all. Now the question is, which such person? So we will see this shloka in continuation to the previous shloka, number 7, in which the characteristic of the Mahabhagavata is described. The one who sees the Supreme Lord, the part of Supreme Lord in every living entity. So this shloka is talking of the same Bhagavata from the Uttamadhikari, the realized soul. So, such a person must factually know the greatest of all, the personality of Godhead, who is unembodied, omniscient, beyond reproach, without veins, pure and uncontaminated, the self-sufficient philosopher
who has been fulfilling everyone's desires since time immemorial. So the Shloka is a very condensed form of knowledge, and now to really understand the full meaning of it, we need a guru to explain to us in detail in the language that we can understand, and also with our limited intelligence in the senses, try to grasp what is said in this. So, what it says is the Supreme Lord is not formless. You know, it's as we have been talking a lot about the Mayavadis who think the Lord is not a person, it's just a universal mind, or there is a system, you know, like a computer program that's running the whole universe. Because when you look at the universe, all the planets are situated in a very definite distance, and they rotate and circumambulate in a specific way. Like it's very systematic, it's not haphazard. If it was haphazard, everything will collide with each other and there will be chaos. But there is a very precise order within the whole universe and the whole universes. So how is that possible? So that means there is a mind or a computer program behind this. But the Isha Upanishad is telling us the supreme truth that the Isha or the supreme controller is not formless. It has a form and it is a person, the supreme personality of Godhead. And that's how you try to understand God, because it's not very easy to understand. So he has his own transcendental form, which is not at all similar to the forms of the mundane world. So now when somebody tells us that, oh, Lord is a person, then our limited intelligence and senses think, you know, he's a person like, you know, one of us. Like he has a, you know, body in flesh, he has bones and he has blood veins running, right? But that is not how the Lord's body is. That is the concept we have to get into our minds to really understand Krishna. The anatomy of the material body must have a mechanical construction like veins, bones, muscles, you know, skin. But the transcendental body of the Supreme Lord has nothing like veins. So that's where the word, you know, meaning veins came into this shloka. Then it is clearly stated that he is unembodied, you know. So, what is the meaning of unembodied? On one hand, they're saying he's a person, and then on the other hand, they're saying he's unembodied. So, these are the inconceivable properties of the Lord that we have to understand. So, the meaning of unembodied in this verse is that there is no difference between his body and his soul. For us, we have this material body, and in this material body, the knower of the material body, the body is called a field, and the knower of the field is the Atma or the soul. So in our case, when the Atma leaves the body is like a dead matter. But Lord's body is not like that. He is spiritual. The whole of the Lord's body is spiritual. And he is not forced to accept the body according to the laws of nature. Now our body is governed by the three modes of nature. You know, the Raja Guna, Sattva Guna and the Tamas Guna. And also we suffer from our karmas and other effects. But Lord's body is not like this. So in that sense, he is not embodied. He doesn't have a material body. That is a concept that we have to put in our brain. So when we see Krishna standing with a cow, don't think like, you know, another gavala or a cowherd boy is standing. We should look at the Lord in his correct perspective, that he is not a material body or a mortal person like us. That's the meaning of unembodied. So he has a form, he is a person, but he is not an ordinary person like you and me. So, Supreme Lord, however, there is never any such difference between him and his body and mind. He is in complete whole, and his mind, body, and he himself are one and the same. And in the Vedic literature is described clearly that the transcendental body of the Lord is completely different than ours, which I just tried to explain. And it's divided up of a form like us, which we conceive when we say, you know, somebody is a person. In the Brahma Samhita, you know, Shloka 32, the Brahma Samhita we have is only the chapter 5, the rest of the chapters are lost. Mahaprabhu could discover only the chapter number 5. It is further stated that with each and every part of his body, he can do the work of the other senses. Which means Lord can walk with his hands. Even some people can also walk. You know, you must have seen people do somersault and walk. But try to understand here is he can accept things with his legs, see with his hands and feet, he can smell with his finger, he can feel with his eyes. So when you offer prasadam, the Lord can accept a prasadam just by looking at it. So this is a totally inconceivable concept that our material senses will not understand. So in the Shruti mantras are which are heard by Vedas, and Smriti mantras are which are written by memory and they are man-made. Shruti mantras are all Purusha, they are not man-made. So it is also said that although the Lord has no hands and legs like ours, he has a different type of hands and legs by which he can accept all that we offer him and run faster than anyone. We, you know, read that shloka, Tejiti na Tejiti. He can run faster than anyone. These points are confirmed in the 8th mantra of the Hindu word, like Shukra. The Shukra means omnipotent. The Lord can do anything that you can conceive or you cannot conceive. Is much more than what we can even conceive. The Lord's worshipable form, Arch Vigraha, which we all pray to, which is installed in the temples and our altars, by authorized acharyas who have realized the Lord in terms of mantra 7. You know, we are supposed to see the Lord everywhere, especially in the daily form. And in mantra 7, it says that the daily form of the Lord is non-different from the Lord. Like the name of the Lord, Krishna, is non-different from himself. Similarly, the daily form of the Lord is also non-different from the Lord. This form may be seen as material by the imperfect senses or eyes of foolish people, because many people call it statues or, you know, they call them idols. But no, we call them deities and they are not different from Krishna. Because they are not just mundane representation of something. They are by scriptural injunctions, they are specific form, and you know everything is given in details how a deity should be. So the foolish people or the Kanishka Adhikaris who are neophytes, they think that, you know, these are material things like stone, wood, other material that the deities are made for. And they should know that Lord can transform the matter into spirit and spirit into matter and whatever he desires. In the Bhagavad Gita chapter 9, verse 11 and 12, the Lord regrets the fallen condition of men with little knowledge who deride him. They are called mudas, or fools, because he descends like a man from this world. So the Lord is warning us that when he comes into this body, in English language, we call it incarnation, but that is not the correct word. The karma in Latin means flesh. So that's why we have carnivorous animals, you know, flesh eating. So when you say incarnation, that means coming in flesh or material body. But the Lord does not come in material body, so he's not an incarnation, he's an avatar. Avatar means to descend. The Lord descends in a spiritual form. So this is a very important concept that we need to keep in our mind. And such poorly informed person do not know the omnipotence of the Lord. Now, we have heard many times that Bhagavatam is the natural commentary of Vedanta Sutra. So what do you mean by natural commentary? So as we get the taste of Vedas from this Isha Upanishad, the shlokas are so intense and so dry that you have to really, you know, need help to understand them. And they are very hard. But when you read Bhagavatam, it is so nectarian. The same things that are given in Vedanta Sutra is given in Bhagavatam in a very nectarian, loving form by describing the devotees of the Lord, the call of Bhagavatam, and the Lord Himself. So that is the meaning of natural commentary. Does the Lord not manifest Himself in full to the mental spectator? So the fools who are, you know, Muras, they think God is material or has a material body. The Lord does not manifest Himself fully to these people. He can be appreciated only in proportion to one's surrender to Him. So in Bhagavad Gita, He says, as you surrender to Me, I will reveal Myself to you. So in the previous picture we saw, Krishna, when Mother Yashoda, when the Gopas came and complained, it was Balaram's birthday actually, and Krishna was eating dirt. So the Gopas came and complained to Mother Yashoda that Krishna is eating dirt. And so Mother Yashoda came and asked Him, are you eating dirt? He says, no, I didn't eat dirt. So this is what the Gopas are telling, that you eat dirt. So open your mouth, show Me. So Krishna opens His mouth, and in the mouth of Krishna, you know, is very small, toddler. Mother Yashoda sees the whole universe. So she sees all the universes. She sees all the living and non-living things. She also sees all the seasons and the, you know, galaxies moving. She also sees herself looking into Krishna's mouth, in His mouth. So she gets totally bewildered. She thought maybe she's not feeling well or something. And then Krishna, that was Krishna's yoga maya. So He takes away the yoga maya and Mother Yashoda recovers. So this is a very beautiful material example of telling that Krishna reveals as much as you want to be revealed, and He can any time take away, you know, the revelation. And He says in Bhagavad Gita also that all the knowledge, the memory and the forgetfulness comes from Krishna. So people who do not look at the Lord with that kind of a devotional attitude do not get any benefits. So then we have the example of Arjuna in Kurukshetra. So in that, Arjuna asked the Lord to reveal His universal form, the Virat Rup. And here we see the description of the Virat Rup. If you read that description of Virat Rup, it is so astonishing. And when Arjuna sees it, he had to get a divine vision to see it, because you cannot see this Rup form with the material eyes. So he was given the divine vision. His hairs were standing on end, and his body was trembling. And then Krishna withdraws His Virat Rup and He begs, I want to again see your, you know, beautiful two-armed form. So please come back to your original state. So then Krishna again produces Sachidananda form. And so, you know, these are the very illustrative and nice presentation that we don't find in Vedanta Sutra. Vedanta Sutra, you know, will give you one or two sentences of shloka and then you'll imagine. But when you read Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita, you can understand all these things in a very nice way, in a very natural way. So that's what we call the natural commentary. So it says, a living being desires something and the Lord supplies the object of the desire in proportion to one's qualification. So it's not that, you know, you go to the temple and say, Krishna, okay, give me a, you know, this, give me that. The Lord is not there, He's not there to serve your order. You know, He's not your servant. You are His servant. But the Lord gives according to one's qualification. So it is, Prabhupada writes that the qualification in themselves are not sufficient for one to occupy a post. Tomorrow you say, oh, I have done, you know, graduation and so, and now I should get this post. It doesn't happen that way. You have to earn that position. not just have the qualification, and that award or position is given by the Lord when He is satisfied. So ordinarily the living being does not know what to ask from the Lord, nor which post to seek. So in Srimad Bhagavatam and Vaishnava, you know, they say we don't ask anything from the Lord, we just want to serve Him, we just want to make Him happy by our service. So it is stated that those who are captivated by the temporary duties of the external energy forget the real aim of life, which is to go back to Godhead. So they ask for material things. Nonetheless, the Lord is so kind that He allows the forgetful living entity to continue in this way without interference. So this mantra, Vishopanishad, uses the very appropriate word, yatha asthyataha. Yatha means life. Like you wish, similarly your Lord reciprocates. So you must have heard this word very often, yatha shakti or yatha, you know, like your ability or what you can do. So similarly, like you approach the Lord reciprocates with you. Indicated the Lord rewards the living entity just in pursuance of their desires. So whatever desires you have in your heart, the Lord will give it to you. So here we have a very nice example, Bhadra Puri is sitting in Vrindavan. And the Lord Himself comes with a pot of sweet rice. So that is Vishopanishad and this is Bhagavatam. So that is the natural commentary. So sweet. The same meaning. So if a living being wants to go to hell, the Lord allows him to do well without interference. So that's why you see people, you know, doing all these mundane activities and falling down. The Lord doesn't stop anybody. And if the living entity wants to go back home, back to Godhead, the Lord helps him. How does the Lord help him? By sending his devotees. And the Lord personally gives the devotee this ocean. This world is described as an ocean, samsara, in which, you know, the living entity is drowning, coming up, you know, suffering. And then the Lord finally takes him back to home, back to this abode. So in this way, the God is described here as Paribhu, the greatest of all. No one is greater than or equal to Him. So this is another very important concept. People like Hiranyaksha or Hiranyakashipu, they thought they were gods and then they were, you know, shown their place. So that is the natural commentary from Bhagavatam. Real liberation means going back to Godhead. Liberation as conceived by an impersonalist is a myth. The impersonalist or Mayavadi think that you merge with that effulgence or merge with that Brahma Jyoti, because there is no God, there is no personal form of a God, and just some universal mind and light that is going merge with. And that is not the supreme reality. Supreme reality is that we can go and associate with the Lord eternally and serve Him. Only the Supreme Lord is self-sufficient. When Lord Krishna appeared on earth 5,000 years ago, He displayed His full manifestation as the personality of Godhead through His various activities. So now, Vishopanishad gives us a very dry instruction that, you know, Lord is self-sufficient, He can do anything He wants. But then Bhagavatam, we see the real life story, you know. Like Krishna and Balram, you know, they are running with the Gopas, with the small caste, because they graduated to serve the caste first before they could take the cows to the pastures. Because the small caste were given to them, so they could control them, not knowing who they are. So, but by their age, they were given that qualification, so they are going with the caste, enjoying and, you know, running. But at the same time, you remember baby infant Krishna killed a fierce damnist called Putana. And this is a Trinava, you know, the hurricane demon. Yes, exactly. Good, Aragorn. That's a whirlwind. So he carried Krishna, but Krishna became so heavy like a mountain, so that Trinava could not carry Krishna and fell down and died. So Then we have this example of Govardhan Leela. The Lord lifted the Govardhan mountain on the pinky of the left hand. For 7 days and seven nights, not for 7 minutes or something, 7 days and seven nights. And to do that, he didn't have to go to the, what is that, Four Seasons gym or, you know, somewhere to go lifting and training to do that. He just did it. He lifted. It says in Bhagavatam, he lifted like the children lift a mushroom or the fairy stool. So that is the inconceivable energy of the Lord. See the difference between Bhagavatam and Vedas, Isha Upanishad. To confirm that the Lord is always pure and uncontaminated, Sri Isha Upanishad describes him as Shuddham. Shuddham means antiseptic. And apap vidham.
Shuddham is pure.
Yes, Shuddham is pure or purifying. So, antiseptic. So, if you are you have some infection or something, you put antiseptic. So, you purify. Or if you are contaminated, you purify yourself. So, Shuddha is pure. Shuddham is to purify. And apap vidham is prophylactic. So that means if you take shelter of the Lord, you become immune from the sins, you know, prophylactic. It's like the example is vaccination. So if you take vaccination, you will not get the disease. You make yourself immune to that disease. So Lord is both Shuddham. So if you are already contaminated, He will purify you. And if you are, you know, in the future, you will get contaminated by any sin, He will prevent you, will save you from getting infected. So it's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter 9, verse 30-31, a devotee. Okay, now it's giving a listing that a devotee who just starting or, you know, is performing devotional service, you might find some four faults in it. But he should be accepted as pure because he's on the right path. So you should overlook any faults in the devotees, you know, as long as he is performing his devotional service. The Lord is also a part with them because sin cannot touch him, even if he acts in a way that appears to be sinful. So if you find some devotee, you know, like he's drinking tea or drinking coffee, or you say, oh, he's not supposed to do that. But you know, the Lord will prevent it, so he will give you the realization, and you do not have to criticize or, you know, deride him for that. And the example of Shuddham given is in, this is in material world, the sun. So when the sun shines, any dirt, you know, any dirty thing lying, it dries up and purifies it. But in doing so, the sun doesn't get dirty. So what to talk of the Lord who created the sun? So it's a, you know, example at a very material level, but Lord is much more because He created the sun, the planets, the whole universes, the whole galaxies, and also the 3/4 is the spiritual world. The material world is only 1/4. So imagine the potency of the Lord. But this example is always given for the sun for purifying. And that concludes today's lecture. Verse number 8. And we are in time. Any questions, any comments? Yes, Prabhu.
So you mentioned about the body form of Krishna. So people use it to misguide, you know, what is written in the Bhagavad Gita. They say that in Bhagavad Gita it is written that Krishna doesn't, like, your God doesn't has any form. It's written in your Bhagavad Gita itself. Then why do you have so many details and everything? Because they don't read the next part. You know, that they misinterpret the shloka actually. I've seen that with one of the YouTube videos of Zakir Naik. He has like thousands of people sitting and one person will be questioning him. Then he says the first thing we have to do is we have to
First, agree on the commonalities between Bhagavad Gita and Quran. So in Quran and Bhagavad Gita both, he quotes the shloka from both the things. And from Bhagavad Gita he says this is a shloka, which means that there is no image of God. So why do you have so many deities? You should, first you should stop worshipping all those.
Yeah, Guru, you're right. Those are they are mudras. They are they call the Prabhupada gives a very nice term for those people. They actually know how to cheat and fool people.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful. That's why we have to know our scriptures and our religion very nicely.
Correct.
And especially for our children.
Correct.
You know, my main concern is our children, because they are growing up in this country, and if you don't give them proper knowledge and understanding, they will be easily fooled by these people.
And the answer that the person was a Hindu person actually, I'm not sure if he was paid or whatever, but probably he was genuine, but the answer that he kept on giving was, what about our sentiments, what about our sentiments? So basically, he was only coming from the sentiment perspective. He was not coming from the knowledge perspective.
Right. If he had the knowledge, he would have argued with him. If he had, you know, heard Ishopanishad or learned Bhagavad Gita, he would have got back to him. You can take out anything from somewhere and, you know, then present it.
Yes.
But that's not a complete knowledge.
There is an example of Quran also. If you read a particular verse on one page and if you don't read in on the same continuation on another page,
right,
it misinterprets what it is saying.
Right.
I don't know what the example is, but there are such examples in Quran also. So.
Right.
Right. So you can do Jnana Yoga, Dhyana Yoga, but unless you envision the Lord in some form, you cannot. I mean, how you can do bhakti?
Right.
Can you do bhakti with the light, singing over this light, so beautiful?
Right.
Cannot do that, right? So.
Right. And if you see, in Christianity, Jesus says, I am son of the Holy Father. Mm-hmm. So if he is the son of the Holy Father, who will be his father? He will be a person, right? Similarly, in Muslims, they call him Allah Mia. Allah Mia. So if he is a Mia, means he is a person. So they all have, and the Jewish, they don't have the name and the form of the Lord. They don't even take his name. In Islam, he has a name, Allah, but he has no form. And in Christianity, he has a name and Christianity, Holy Father. He has a designation, but he has no name. Jesus is not a God. He says, I am the Son of God, right? But they have made him God. So he has no name. He has a designation, but no name and no form. Whereas in Sanatana, the Lord has name, fame, form, even have his address. Lives and goes in the world. Apart from being everywhere, everything being in him, we have his own address. You can put on the GPS and go.
Back to that.
Yes. The GPS address is written over there. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Keep saying that, the GPS will take you there. So, Vaishnava philosophy is the highest philosophy. And they don't even have concept of Golok Vrindavan. Like other religions, they talk of heaven. The heaven described in the religion is the Swarga Lok in the Sanatana Dharma of Vedic literature. That is where Indra lives, where there is wine, women, 72 virgins, wine, women and music, Kada, Vidyasagar and all those are there. Yes, that is the definition of heaven for them. But for us, above the Swarga Lok, there is a Brahma Lok, Shiva Lok, and then the Golok. And then a topmost of Golok is the Golok Vrindavan, where Krishna is personally present. So it's a very highest form of knowledge. And he said that other people were given knowledge but not complete because they were not ready for it. So you give knowledge according to the time and the qualification of the person who is listening. So that's what it is. So people try to fool, and a lot of people are getting fooled in India. If you go on the Facebook and all, it's called No Conversion. There's so many, you know, illiterate poor people are being fooled and converted to Christianity and Islam by this showing them. So, that's why you require this knowledge and be able to, you know, discuss with people and present it to them, and especially for our children. So thank you very much, Hare Krishna. What about you, Tushar? Mother, you have brought some yogurt. It's in the fridge. You can give that to you. So is it ready? Can I say it up, Tushar?
Incarnation. You said incarnation means getting into flesh or something, right? It's just the same skin on the top.
Right.
And then, and we define the, there is no form, there is no particular caste, and we can say this is God and this is God. Right? He is definable as well as not definable.
That's what right. I'm saying. Right.
So this very Swarupa of Krishna, what is that? Is that still, we would still call that the incarnation, or is it kind of, I don't know, I want to understand that.
It's called the Archbhujara, the worshipable form. You know, whatever deity you put, whether you put a picture or whether you put a, you know, stone deity or a wood deity or whatever, it's called the Archvigraha or the worshipable form. Archvigraha. Archa means worship. Archana. Vigraha means form. So it's a worshipable form. So Lord can assume millions of forms. He has, you know, we read them Dashavataras, but he has millions of forms and millions of things. So he can be in any form, but the form that we relate to is Devaki Nanda, Nanda Gopala.
This is one of the forms.
One of the form of Lord, yes. It's a bona fide form, the sweetest form, and most benevolent and, you know, beneficial form.
And then we have to understand that this is not similar to what we are.
It is right. Right.
That's why it is not an incarnation.
Yes. It's not flesh. So that's the concept.
Yeah, Prabhupada argues in the Bhagavad Gita that if Krishna is the complete personality, then he has to have a form. Because how can something be complete if it doesn't have a form? If it's formless, it's not complete.
Oh, okay.
And then, this is the shloka I was trying to find. Is the Bhagavad Gita 7, chapter 7, 24. Krishna says, unintelligent men who do not know me perfectly think that I, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, was impersonal before and now I've assumed this personality. Due to their small knowledge, they do not know my higher nature, which is imperishable and supreme. So Krishna himself says that stupid people think that I didn't have a form before, but I've assumed this form now. Because they don't know the truth.
The beauty of Krishna, he says, I am the Supreme Father. I am the creator of everything. Now, Jesus Christ says, I am son of God. Muhammad says, I am the savior of Allah. They are messengers of Islam. Krishna here says, I am this thing. I am the time. So, it's clear, very clear there. Mahaprasade Govinde.
Mahaprasade Govinde.
Namo Brahmane Vaishnave.
Namo Brahmane.